Peter, could you introduce yourself?
Hi, Jonathan. Glad to do that. I'm now a professor of law and ethics at Georgia Tech. I've been a law professor working on privacy and civil liberties issues for more than two decades. I worked in the White House under President Clinton on privacy, and I was in President Obama's review group on intelligence and communications technologies, the so-called NSA review group.
Why don't we start with a little bit of history? Foreign intelligence before the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act.
Well, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act happened in response to Watergate and the things we learned then. I think for students these days, one of the easiest ways to think about it is what happened to Martin Luther King during the 60s when he was a civil rights leader. J. Edgar Hoover, the FBI director, and his people were pervasively wiretapping the hotel rooms and phone calls of Martin Luther King. And they even threatened to blackmail him when he went to get his Nobel Peace Prize if he went and accepted it. So we had illegal wiretaps, no judges on board. That was the world we found out about when Watergate happened. We also found out that the agencies that were supposed to be doing overseas things were doing them at home. The CIA, the National Security Agency, they were getting telegrams and phone calls and postal mail and all sorts of things inside the United States about Americans. The U.S. Army had developed huge files on Americans. And so the idea that a military and foreign intelligence apparatus was being turned on citizens was something that was deeply concerning when the Church Commission and the other investigations of the 1970s found out how the national surveillance state had grown way beyond what any Americans had imagined.
So one response to these revelations was the creation of the House and Senate Intelligence Committees. Another, of course, was the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. Could you explain how FISA tried to strike a compromise between intelligence and democracy?
I think FISA was pretty brilliant the way they set it up. The problem is, how do you do secret intelligence in an open democracy? How do you do that? Well, one thing that you do is you don't want to reveal when you're wiretapping a Russian spy and the Russian spy doesn't know it. That Russian spy might have been in the United States, for instance. So you want to have a secret surveillance on the spy, but how do you have accountability? Who guards the guardians? The trick was, we're going to take judges, regular Article III judges, life tenure judges, people that we trust that have been confirmed by the Senate, named by the President. We're going to take those judges, and they're going to get the security clearance, and they're going to watch what goes on. And having a general purpose judge watching the specialized spy stuff was a way to have the most accountability we could think of to have rule of law come to this intelligence surveillance stuff.
So originally, FISA judges would review individual wiretap orders.
Right. So the original idea was there had to be probable cause that someone was an agent of a foreign power, classically a communist spy, but maybe a terrorist as well. But it would be an individual wiretap on an individual suspect. The judge would look at the evidence, decide there was enough evidence that this person was an agent of a foreign power, and then the wiretap could start inside the United States based on our foreign affairs powers.
Over time, the FISA authorities shifted. And there were some dramatic shifts in the 21st century, including the USA Patriot Act and the FISA Amendments Act. What's your perspective on those shifts?
So really, from the 1978 FISA until the attacks of 2001, the system was quite stable. There were minor tweaks because of technology changes, et cetera, but the basic system worked for a quarter century. When 9/11 happened, people said, we need to do something. We need to connect the dots. We need to do better at finding these terrorists. And so there were huge changes in the so-called Patriot Act of 2001. And the USA Patriot Act, among other things, made a change to take down what was called the wall. The old idea was that we have criminal justice at home with extra safeguards, and we have foreign affairs power to go after the enemies of the United States. But you shouldn't take the foreign affairs superpowers and use them for everyday criminal activities. And that was the wall. Only in special cases with careful attention could you take your spy stuff and use it for criminal prosecution. This was part of the philosophy that we don't want to give too much power to the spy agencies to meddle at home. In the Patriot Act, the wall came down. The idea was if we found something in our foreign intelligence work, we could use it for criminal prosecution. The prosecutors could put the bad guys in jail in the United States, and that would stop them from doing the terrorist attacks. It was a great idea in terms of efficacy, of trying to move and take action against the terrorists. The concern is really, are we unleashing these foreign affairs superpowers back home for domestic purposes? There were other changes as we went through the 2000s. The biggest happened after it turned out that there had been a massive program of warrantless wiretaps. It meant there was no judge involved. They went around the FISA court And President Bush and his lawyers said that they had inherent power as president and commander-in-chief to do this without warrants. That's contrary to what FISA said. FISA said if you're going to use your foreign affairs powers, you have to use FISA. There were debates during the mid-2000s. Eventually, they passed some amendments to FISA. Some of them, I think, make sense. So if there's a phone call from Pakistan that's being routed to the UK, but it happens to touch down in the United States, in other words, it's a foreign-to-foreign call, they changed it so it was clear that you could do the surveillance if it happened to touch down in the United States. There were other amendments, such as Section 702, that you might talk about with your class, which is if there was a terrorist on one end of the line or email and they were communicating back home, we could get FISA to grab the contents of that information. It might have been an email at home with one American, but we were going to be able to get the bad guy overseas. Those were two of the biggest changes that they had during the 2000s. One important part of the Patriot Act that we weren't sure whether was important originally is Section 215 of the Patriot Act. That says that the government can get any other records with a minimum oversight by the judges. And in the first 3 years that the 215 existed, the Justice Department went up to Congress and swore that they had not used 215 for anything. Later on, we found out that they switched to using 215 once the warrantless wiretaps were revealed. And so there were a massive collection of phone calls, metadata about Americans under this power that originally they said they hadn't used.
So on the books and in early practice, Section 215 didn't draw too much attention. We now know, of course, that it's the basis for a bulk surveillance program. Could you explain how these authorities that didn't seem so expansive came to be more expansive?
One way to think about it is the old FISA, the traditional Title I of FISA, was for the individual spy or terrorist. When it came to 215, we started to hear about the 215 program. So it was more like a whole system of ways that an enormous database was being created. The judge wasn't looking at one person's wiretap anymore. The judge was almost like an administrative agency trying to say what kind of safeguards we needed for this great big database of complicated collections of metadata. Judges were moving from case by case to being an administrative agency. As that happened, the judges had to decide what's okay and what's not okay. And they have a natural instinct, I think. They're only hearing one side of the story. The judges hear, well, we have this problem. There's bad guys who are getting away and we can't find them. The judges are only hearing that side of the story. And what tends to happen over time is that the authorities expand and expand. The other problem for the judges is that they're not technologists. They're not in the middle of the program seeing what's really happening. And there was a big disconnect in the middle 2000s between what the judges thought they were allowing and what some of the programs actually were doing. I think in retrospect, some of it or a lot of it was innocent. In other words, the technologists thought they were following the law. The judges thought they had stricter limits in place. But there definitely was a disconnect that the judges started to find out about around 2009.
One criticism that's been leveled at the FISA process as it currently stands is that it lacks adversarial legal proceedings, at least in general. Another has been this lack of technical expertise. Quite a few possibilities have been kicked around for reforming the process. And I'm curious what your thoughts are on the various options.
Well, our review group said that we thought there should be greater technological help to the FISA court. Greater technological help also to the Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board when they do their oversight activities. In terms of adversarial proceedings, there's different ways you can do it, but I think the key thing is for the judges to be able to get a brief from a zealous advocate who's looking at something other than the Justice Department point of view. And that person probably needs to have a pretty strong security clearance in order to know the facts well enough to make the argument. There's different ways you could build it, but having somebody to make the argument in the room with the FISA judges is something I think we've learned we need, because otherwise these administrative structures build up and no one's really criticizing them.
Another possible direction for reform that's been kicked around is altering the rules of decision for the FISA court, a sort of, if it's not clear that a surveillance authority has been granted by law, then perhaps the FISA court should decline to find that authority and return the matter to Congress. What do you think about that possible direction for reform?
It sounds like you're proposing a sort of presumption, the way insurance companies are, it's assumed to be read against the insurance company and in favor of the consumer. And here you're suggesting we should read the statute in favor of the citizen who's being surveilled instead of the government that's doing the surveilling. I think that's a tough way for people steeped in national security to think about things. The president, the commander-in-chief, the people trying to save our country from enemies foreign and domestic, that's a very strong argument. And saying that it's suspect whenever they act, I think is the wrong way to think about the law. I think the right way is try to write rules that make sense, try to have checks and balances that work over time.
For the most part, FISA is focused on domestic operations. Foreign operations are generally governed by the president's inherent Article II authority, as embodied in Executive Order 12333. How did that divide come to be, and does that divide still make sense?
Well, Executive Order 12333 dates back more than 30 years. It's pretty obvious that if you're in a war zone, that the Army is going to do surveillance and try to make sure they're spying on the enemy, and that's to keep our soldiers safe. And it's also pretty obvious in a spy versus spy world that if you're in the Soviet Union during the Cold War, that you're going to have pretty strong authorization to find out the stuff you need to protect our nuclear secrets or whatever. So the history has been we have extra special protections for U.S. citizens and also for the people who are in the United States, because that's where our Constitution applies most strongly. That's where the safeguards are strongest. So FISA is the rules for doing foreign intelligence surveillance inside the United States. That's the basic set of rules. But historically, it's been pretty much open season when you're doing foreign intelligence surveillance outside of the United States. 12333 sets the rules for how that operates. It puts parameters on what is allowed or not allowed. But it's much broader when you're spying on potential enemies and adversaries than it is when you're spying on citizens. And so the history has always been there's a greater latitude when the surveillance is pointed overseas.
As a policy matter, setting aside the legal analysis for a moment, broad surveillance of foreign populations under 12333 has come under a lot of criticism. Historically, it has not been a focus for review by Congress or even within the executive branch. Do you believe the programs that have come to light suggest greater oversight of 12333 is required?
In terms of 12333, the president issued a very important policy directive, number 28, last January, in January of 2014. And for the first time, the United States government is saying that we're going to treat citizens of other countries outside of the United States with significant protections. It's no longer spy versus spy, whatever you want to do overseas. Instead, there's going to be a set of procedures and softwares and institutions to treat people in other countries, Germans and elsewhere, as people. That's an important change. How to build it is something people are still working out. But I think that's a good thing. There are other problems under 12333. One of the ones the review group focused on is the so-called backdoor wiretapping. So if there's wiretapping that happens overseas under 12333, you could potentially create a database about Americans that you gathered overseas and then start searching that and then start using that in criminal proceedings. So the review group had a series of recommendations, and the House of Representatives voted to discontinue funding for those kinds of operations. We don't have that built into law, but that kind of backdoor wiretapping of Americans has turned out to be a hot-button issue, and the review group, I think, helped draw attention to it.
Incidental collection has drawn quite a lot of concern. The idea is surveillance directed at foreigners outside the United States inherently involves a lot of information to, from, or about Americans. And everyone knows it involves a lot of information concerning Americans. The law, as the executive branch interprets it, emphasizes just the target of surveillance. What's your view of whether law or policy must change to accommodate the reality that with modern information technology, there's going to be a tremendous amount of incidental collection?
In terms of incidental collection, we've actually had safeguards in place since the beginning of FISA. Inside the NSA, these were called USID 18, and they were the U.S. Signals Intelligence Directive 18 was saying that for U.S. persons, U.S. citizens and people who are permanent residents, for U.S. persons, it will get collected, but then we're going to do what's called minimization on the data. And in a wide range of instances, instead of it saying, this is Peter Swire, it'll say U.S. person number one. And that was in order to allow the intelligence to go forward, but to provide a cover of safeguards when it came to U.S. persons. There's been questions about how well the minimization works in all the different ways data is used today. I think that should be revisited. And the backdoor wiretapping is one of the places where we had concerns in the review group that the traditional safeguards were not as extensive enough.
You served on the President's Intelligence Review Group. What was the motivation for forming that group? And what was the group's responsibility?
So the Snowden revelations happened in June of 2013. In early August, it happened to be 5 days after my wedding. I hadn't even gotten home from the honeymoon. I got a call that somebody in the White House wanted to speak to me. I didn't know why. I wondered what I had done. It turned out that they were creating this review group on what had happened with the NSA. They ended up with five people doing it. Michael Morell had been the number two person in the CIA. Cass Sunstein's a famous law professor who had been in the government. Jeffrey Stone had hired young Barack Obama to be a law professor at the University of Chicago. And Richard Clark's a cybersecurity expert. I was there as somebody who'd been doing FISA and a lot of these other issues for a long time. The five of us on the review group were intended to be people with deep government experience, with an array of different insight into the different technical issues, who could give the president advice about what to do in the wake of these NSA reforms. There was, of course, a lot of discussion within the NSA, within all of the other parts of the government about how to do change. I think the view was that if we had five people who knew the government but were outside of the government, there could be a fresh look and we'd have a chance to give the president better advice, broader advice, and a different point of view from the people who were protecting their turf. So we were stood up in August of 2013, and we were given a short deadline till December 1st to finish the report. So we basically wrote a book in 90 days. It's been republished by Princeton University Press. We had 46 recommendations. We covered really a big picture view as well as details on what we thought should happen in the wake of the NSA revelations.
And what was your perception of how the revelations were received within the intelligence community?
Our review group report was taken very seriously. When the president did his speech in January of 2014, we were told by his senior advisors that they had accepted 70% of our 46 recommendations in letter or in spirit. In life, as a consultant or an advisor or a government review committee, that's a high percentage. The intelligence community did not like our views about how to restructure the NSA. And the president, in the end, decided to go with them on that one. But I think for a lot of our recommendations about Section 215 and domestic databases, the administration has now adopted it. One of our biggest themes was that these decisions about surveillance were not just the intelligence community's decisions. They were affecting our allies, our economic activities in the world, privacy and civil liberties. And so one of the themes of our report was that the different parts of the government who care about different things had to be brought into the loop for these decisions. Before we surveil foreign powers, before we do sensitive intelligence collection, when we have zero-day exploits that are being kept on the shelf to use against people, there was a whole range of places where we said the Commerce Department, the economic advisors, the State Department, others need to be in the loop because they understand that the internet, the communications infrastructure we're depending on, they understand that these communications things have a lot more to do than just be surveillance conduits. And if that's the single biggest theme of our report in many ways, and trying to have a broader sense of responsibility for how to build a good internet is something that I believe in strongly, and I hope we've taken some significant steps to help with.
So the revelations in recent years have drawn some natural comparisons to revelations in the 1970s. What's your sense of how parallel they are or how different they are?
Here's one parallel between the 1970s and what happened recently. There were huge leaks and then huge public disclosures that had never happened before. And because of that, the citizenry became aware of much bigger programs of surveillance than people had expected. So that's similar. There's some heartening differences, though. One thing that we found in the 1970s was systematic lawbreaking for specific criminal statutes. There was a book written in the 1970s by Jerry Berman, Mort Halpern, and others called The Crimes of the U.S. Intelligence Agencies. And every chapter had another agency that had broken another set of laws. You can't write that same kind of report, in my view, today. What you did see, in my view, during the 2000s was a period after 9/11 where people were building warrantless systems, and they were doing it without, in my view, correct legal authority. But by 2009, the judges were back doing the reviews, the courts were back checking how things were done. And the NSA had already, by the time we came on the job in the review group, hired over 300 people to do compliance work from 2009 to 2013. That compliance program was built and in operation before Snowden's revelations and before the review group went in. So we found a very substantial effort on compliance, which is very different from the, we hope nobody will ever find out what we're doing, which is a lot of what we found, I think, in the 1970s.